hold of it.
Where to sit on her?
Yeah, where would I like to sit?
Should we have that as our table?
Church for this service of the Eucharist on this second Sunday in Advent. It's lovely that yesterday we had been after 8 years, but we needed a break, and the fourth break we had there, the lantern break. Various stalls in the town hall and through the town, and the fireworks and all that would be lovely to see. And we had a fossil friend of Perry School. I don't have a figure for what they've raised, but thank you to all those that made things at the store and looked after it through the day. That's great. So we will have a short figure in due course. We have, well, the good news is that David Bevan is now out of hospital, and he's with his son, and he's sounded a bit stronger than like himself when I spoke to him on the phone. So that was good news. But we also have some sad news. Denise Humphreys, who many people know, worship Holy Trinity and led the handicap club for decades. Sadly, has died yesterday, something in the street. So we remember her and our friends and her family. It is what we call Toy Sunday, where we gather in toys, presents for Christmas for children in need, principally in the town. And I noticed that some have already gathered up at the altar, and we will add to them, I see that there are some more to come up. So perhaps when I have the altar for communion, I might bring them up.
Thank you.
Christ be with
you. And also with you.
Will you please sit for a moment? So we come to light the second Advent candle. Remembering today John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, his forerunner. Saviour who would bring peace, you help them to spread the joyful message of his coming kingdom. Help us as we prepare to celebrate his birth, to share with those around us the good news of your power and life. We ask this through Jesus Christ, the light of his coming into the world. Father, and eternal, giver of light and grace, we have sinned against you and against our name. In what we have thought, in what we have said and done, give us to release our own deliberate thought. We have wounded your love and marked your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all of his past, and lead us out of the house, who walk with the children of life. Amen.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
sins and wickedness, we are grievously hindered in running the race that is set before us. With bountiful grace and mercy, may speedily help and deliver us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, the hope of you and the Holy Spirit, the honour and glory, now and forever. Amen. So we can sit for our first meeting.
The first reading is from Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. My brothers and sisters, I thank my God every time I remember you. I'm constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think thus this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defence and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with the compassion of Jesus and the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight, to help you to determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced a harvest of righteousness that comes from Christ Jesus, for the glory and praise of God. Can we now say together the Canticle of Benedictus, which is on your new sheet? Blessed be the Lord, our God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born in the house of the servant David. He and his holy prophets go across the world to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us. Show mercy to our ancestors, and remember his holy God. This was the earth the Lord swore to our father Abraham, and set us free from the hands of our enemies.
Please stand for the gospel. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Asanias, ruler of Abilene. During the high priest of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. And the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Please be seated. So let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be accepted. I think Rosie drew the short straw there with all those difficult names and places. So this morning I'm looking at John the Baptist from the beginning of chapter 3 of Luke, verses 1 to 6. And I have to be careful because it would be very easy to look at John the Baptist and start talking about what he said about ethics in the following verses in 7 to 18. But Bob is probably going to be speaking about those next week, and I can't leave him with nothing to talk about. So this week I'm going to try and stick to these first six verses. And if you like, I'm just like a forerunner to prepare Bob for next week, which he's going to be preaching. In that same way, we could say that John the Baptist is a forerunner to prepare people for Jesus. It doesn't mean that John the Baptist is unimportant, in other words, the person that comes before is not the main person, because in fact, John the Baptist is very important. I wonder if you've ever considered that two of the Gospels don't mention Christmas at all. Mark's Gospel doesn't mention it. John's Gospel doesn't mention it. However, you can't get rid of John the Baptist. All four Gospels record the story of John the Baptist. So he is important. John's preaching was a message of repentance for all people, both Jew and Gentile. There were no exceptions. He told people that the world was broken and they needed to acknowledge their need of a saviour. So that resonates with us today. It's significant to hear that today because so many people tell us we don't need God. We can do it all ourselves. But the Christian position is that we agree with John the Baptist. We are not good enough in ourselves, and we need to repent. On our own, humanity isn't getting better. There's a darkness in the universe. And that darkness is in each one of us. And without the light of Christ, there is ultimately only darkness. For many people, the word repentance, it's not really used in everyday terms, but the word repentance has negative overtones. It brings to mind guilt and threats of God wanting to punish us. But repentance has often been spoken about as a turning around, a turning away. And there are some things which Christians should speak out against and seek to avoid. They should speak out, I believe, against the influence of materialism, exploitation of the poor, or the plundering of the world's resources. And the latter is very topical in these days of climate change. A positive way of thinking about repentance is choosing to walk with God in his direction. You might remember that famous verse from Micah, prophet Micah. we must do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. So the point about the passage from Luke today is that God wants us to walk with him. And God isn't just concerned with powerful people or influential people. God wants everyone, ordinary people. If you look at this passage from John again, it says, in the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius. And then it goes on, Herod was ruler, and brother Philip ruler, and Lysanias ruler of Abilene. They're all high and mighty people. There are 7 authority figures mentioned. But the word of God doesn't come to the 7 powerful ones. It comes instead to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. This is a man who lives in the wilderness. But I wonder if you've ever considered that this wasn't John on holiday or even a spiritual retreat. If you remember, John was born to Zechariah and Elizabeth, who was the cousin of Mary, the mother of Jesus. So John was related to Jesus. And in chapter 1, we're told about the amazing birth of John and his father Zechariah, who speaks out powerfully words about his son John. He says, the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel. John wasn't an occasional visitor to the wilderness. This was his life. If you wanted to send him a Christmas card, it would be addressed John the Baptist, the desert. So just think of this. The most significant action of God in the cosmos was taking place in the desert. So translate all of this into modern day life, and what do we learn? There is as much darkness now as there ever was. When you hear of world leaders who are murderers in positions of great power and influence, you realise that nothing has really changed since the days of Herod. You hear on the news of Yemen and Syria, the plight of Christians killed for their faith. You soon realise that left to our own devices, we are not on a march to perfection. There's no human solution to our darkness. The start of change can only occur in each one of us as we begin with repentance. And as John says, by acknowledging our own desperate need to walk with God. If we want change which lasts, then it will not be political change or economic change. Out of our materialistic culture, it's interesting that many people don't want to consider more deeply the nature of the world that we live in. There's a desire by many to go beyond the superficial life, which we're often encouraged to think about, feeding our craving for consumerism. There's a contemporary writer called Professor Hawking, and he said that the great threat to human life was artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence meaning robots. Well, I'm sure that robots can be very dangerous, but I think that the greatest threat to human life is artificial humanity. And this is when we deny that we're spiritual beings, created in the image of God. When we deny our spiritual need of God and imagine that we're just material beings, sufficient in ourselves, and we reduce the value of human life as we are artificial humans. The prophet Isaiah said, The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. Of course, very many people haven't seen that great light. John called people to a baptism of repentance. And that means that we recognise that we can't fix ourselves. We all need God. If John the Baptist were alive today, he would be calling people back to recognise that we need his baptism of repentance, because we need for people to see that light in our time. Now, I was reading this week about a painting by Peter Bruegel, who lived in the 1500s, and he painted this picture about the preaching of St. John. And if you look at it, you can see that the audience is very diverse. You'll see all manners of workers and peasants, people of different classes, and of course there are people from different nations and backgrounds. Bruegel wanted to emphasise that the message which John the Baptist preached was meant for all. And there's an interesting technique which the artist has used, which is to paint in such a way that you are placed as if you were there at that time and listening to the words of John. You and I are called to that baptism of repentance, to walk that walk with God in the light. So may we all choose this Advent to walk with God, each one of us, and the people that we come into contact with, that come through these doors of the church, or indeed outside during this festive season. May we all hear afresh the call of John to walk with God, and come to the joy of knowing God's love.
So we profess our faith in God, who invites us to walk his way. John the Baptist spoke to prepare the way for the coming of us. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
One Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, the only begotten of the Father, God of God, light of light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of all the beginning of the Father, through whom all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he became God from heaven, was the Father of the Holy Spirit, and the Word of the man, and was made man. The Lord's giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son,
Father and the Son worship and glorify, who has spread the truth of us. We believe in one very Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
So we kneel and sit to pray. Response to the big blessed Lord, hear us, is, and set your people free. Blessed Lord, hear us,
and set your people free.
But gracious God, we give you thanks for all the promises of your love and your presence among us. We give thanks to John the Baptist for preparing the way for our Savior. We give thanks to the apostles. Mighty God, guide and empower the preacher of the word and ministers of the sacraments. Bless all who proclaim your love and glory through the arts, the music, the broadcasting, and the publishing. All who prepare hearts and minds for your coming. Blessed Lord, hear us.
And set your people.
Pray for all who are prisoners of tyranny and oppression, all whose armies are blind to your rule and deaf to your word. And for all who do not know or love you, all whose lives are darkened by you. So we pray for the church and our world, particularly the Christians. Persecutions, witness to you involve suffering on occasion death. We pray for the church in the Middle East, our brothers and sisters in Sudan and South Sudan, the church in the Bible. We also pray for the nations of the world. Work in health and education. Pray for its work, particularly in the sphere of climate change and preserving the environment. Pray that our repentance of our greed and of our abuse of natural world may lead us to change not only our thinking but our actions. Blessed Lord, hear us and set your people free. We give thanks to all who taught us the faith and led us to you. All who have given us the glimpse of your hope. We pray for teachers. Those who work with young people, for the spouse and for the ways they've done. For those who gather in the Trinity this morning, for the families of this. Pray for our local schools, particularly for those who have a special responsibility for the parish, above them and the Holy Trinity. For all schools that have to navigate difficult circumstances with the COVID threats that are around us. And we pray for all involved in our healthcare and national health service, for many people that have really difficult jobs and are very charismatic, and among them we name David Benn, Gloria Alcock, Jennifer Fenton, Alex Craig, John Friedman, Alice Keithley, Sharon Keaton, John Kemp, Hilary Lee, Jane Moss, Henry Mond, Thomas, Christopher, Conrad Curtis, and others known to us. Bless the Lord, hear us, and set all we need. Lord, Lord, destroy the darkness of the shadow of death, and open the kingdom of heaven to your love for us. We pray for the heart, and in your love there may rejoice in peace, and among them we name Denise Humphreys, Daphne Nanbor, Robert Shepherd, Owen Hardy, Ruth Gordon, and all who have died during the pandemic. Grant them the rest of the Lord, and my perpetual shine upon them, may they rest in peace and rise through Christ in glory. So we unite our prayers with the prayers of all your saints, throughout the age. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers. The sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
You please stand as we share the peace by smiling at peace to each other, sung the peace not only among us here, but for those who are viewing this online and receive this later on today. Know in your life the love of God, the forgiveness of sins, and the joy of salvation. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord. So, we 67 is up here as we prepare the water.
Thank you.
rain on the scattered fields and the great swamps dispersed on the hillside are now reunited on this table in bread and wine. So, Lord, may your whole church soon be gathered together from the corners of the earth into your kingdom. Amen. Generous God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, at your table we present money, consider the work you have given us to do. Use it, use us for the service of your will, for the glory and your name. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift our hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise for your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Savior. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising a new life. So he fulfilled the order and won for you a holy being. And now we give you thanks, because you sent him to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us inheritors of everlasting life. But when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, be made in victory before his appearing, and in confidence stand before him. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, same way after supper he took the cup and gave you thanks. He broke it at the gate to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for me, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Christ is bread of
when we eat his bread and drink his blood, it will be made more bread for Jesus until we come out.
So far, according to mind, his death and the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world. Rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming of glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve. Send the Holy Spirit, your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. So here we'll sit to continue our prayers as we say together the words, the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. So we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one another. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his side. Lord, have your word to receive you, the only Savior of the world, and I shall be with you.
Thank you.
have sent the Son to redeem the world, and will send the dead to be our judge. Give us grace so to imitate him in the humility and purity of his first coming, that when he comes again, we may be ready to greet him with joyful love and firm faith through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Faithful baptism. A faithful God, in baptism, you have adopted us as your children, made us members of God in Christ, and chosen us as inheritors of your kingdom. We thank you that in this Eucharist, you renew your promises within us, empower us by your Spirit, to witness and to serve, and send us out as disciples of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you, scatter the darkness from before your heart, and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you, now and always. Amen. So we stand to sing our final hymn, 282-282.
Wednesday, after the Eucharist on Wednesday,
we'll be having a communion with a focus on the church in Myanmar, and Mama will hopefully be able to update us on what's going on there. And thank you for all those who supported the Harvest People project. I think we've got over £1,300 so far, that's brilliant. So thank you for that. So, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.